Today I'd like to introduce you to incidence geometry. Incidence geometry is the study of incidence structures, which are informally a system of two types of objects, points and lines, and a single type of relationship between those objects, incidence. You can think of incidence geometry as geometry where all we care about is what points are on what lines. Things we don't care about in incidence geometry include angles, continuity, length, and even betweenness. That is, we don't make the distinction that some point comes before or after another point on a line, only whether they are incident to that line. More formally, an incidence structure is a triple, PLI, where P is a non-empty set of objects called points, L is a possibly empty set of objects called lines, and I is the incidence relation between points and lines. If you recall the formal definition of a relation, we can say that I is a subset of the Cartesian product of P with L. And the elements of I are ordered pairs, P sub I, L sub K, where P sub I is a point and L sub K is a line. If a point and a line appear together in an element of I, our incidence relation, we say they're incident with each other. Let's look at an example of an incidence structure. This incidence structure has point set P with elements A, B, and C. It has line set L with elements L sub 1 and L sub 2. Points A and B are incident with line L sub 1, and points B and C are incident with line L sub 2. So our incidence relation is the set of ordered pairs A L sub 1, B L sub 1, B L sub 2, C L sub 2. Now, if I give you the following incidence structure, could you draw it? Feel free to pause the video and draw the incidence structure, and then we'll do it together. First, let's place our points, A, B, C, and D. And next, let's draw our lines. Line L sub 1 appears in the same ordered pair in I as points A, B, and C. So we can draw line L sub 1 through points A, B, and C. Line L sub 2 appears in the same ordered pair in I as points C and D. So we can draw line L sub 2 through points C and D. This is our result. It's important to note that when we create a visual representation of an incidence structure, it doesn't matter what order we place the points on our lines, because again, betweenness is not something we're concerned about. At the same time, our lines don't even have to be straight. They can be curved as necessary so that they go through all the points that they are defined to be incident to. Our lines could even be circles. Points can also be drawn as close or as far apart as we wish. If an incidence structure can be visually represented with only points and straight lines in the Euclidean plane, it's called realizable. One example of an incidence structure that is not realizable is the Fano plane, which is defined to have the point set A through G, line set 1 through 7, and the following incidence relation. It would help to see what this famous incidence structure looks like. It requires the use of one curved line. In this labeling and representation, that would be line 7, which appears as a circle. Again, don't be confused, this circle is just the pictorial representation of line 7, incident to points C, E, and F. The Fano plane also demonstrates the concept of uniform incidence structures, which are incidence structures where all lines are incident with the same number of points. The Fano plane is a three-uniform incidence structure because all lines are incident with 3 points. Another example of a uniform incidence structure is a graph, where the point set is the vertex set of the graph, the line set is the edge set of the graph, and the incidence relation is the set of ordered pairs of vertices and edges that are incident with each other in the graph. A graph would be a two-uniform incidence structure because each edge is incident to exactly 2 vertices. Moving on, any incidence structure can be represented by an incidence matrix, where the rows of the incidence matrix correspond to points and the columns correspond to lines. and in which the entry ij in the matrix equals 1 if point I is incident to line j, or equals 0 otherwise. Notice that the incidence matrix is not unique. We could change our ordering of points and lines and obtain a different matrix that also represents the incidence structure. However, they are unique up to permutations of the rows and columns, and any incidence matrix of a structure allows us to recover the entire structure. As an example, let's find the incidence matrix of this incidence structure. A is incident to line L sub 1, but not to line L sub 2, so we can fill in the row corresponding to A accordingly. B is incident to line L sub 1, but not to line L sub 2, so we can now fill in its row as well. C is incident to both lines, so its row will be all 1s. D is incident to line L sub 2, but not L sub 1, so we can fill in its row accordingly and complete our matrix. Now, by changing the order of our rows, we obtain another valid incidence matrix for our structure, and we could obtain yet another by changing the order of our columns. Moving on, note that the sum of a column tells us how many points are incident to the line corresponding to that column, and the sum of a row tells us how many lines are incident to the point corresponding to that row. Next, let's introduce the idea of a dual structure. If we have an incident structure S with point set P, line set L, and incidence relation I, then its dual, S star, is the incident structure with L as its point set, P as its line set, and the converse relation of I as its incidence relation, which, if you recall, is what we get by swapping the left and right entries of the incidence relation. Intuitively, the dual structure is what we get when we turn points into lines and lines into points, preserving all incidences between objects of different types. As an exercise, can you find the dual of this incident structure? First, list out the points, which will be the lines of the original structure, 1 and 2. Then, list out the lines, which will be the points of the original structure, A, B, C, and D. Then, find the incidence relation, which is the converse relation of I. This is our result. Now, let's examine the incidence matrices of the structure and its dual. What are these matrices? Transposes of each other. This will always be the case, as points are represented by rows and lines by columns, and finding the dual turns points into lines and lines into points, preserving pairwise incidence. The effect of this on the incidence matrix will be transposition. This fact lets us use incidence matrices to analyze the relationship between an incidence structure and its dual. It lets us test for self-duality, that is, incidence structures that, when we take the dual, look the same, or more formally, incidence structures that are isomorphic to their duals. An incidence structure is self-dual if and only if some ordering of its points and lines produces an incidence matrix that is symmetric. For starters, this implies an incidence structure can only be self-dual if it has the same number of points as lines. The Fano plane that we looked at earlier does have the same number of points as lines. So is it self-dual? It turns out that it is self-dual. According to the following ordering of points and lines, we can build an incidence matrix for the Fano plane that is symmetric. And visually, the dual of the Fano plane and the Fano plane look the same. The last thing I'd like to show you about incidence geometry is its relationship to hypergraph theory. If you haven't already, I suggest you check out my video on hypergraphs for some background information. It turns out that every hypergraph can be viewed as an incidence structure, whose point set is the hypergraph's vertex set, whose lines are the edges in the hypergraph's edge family, and whose incidence relation is the set of all ordered pairs of incident vertices and edges in the hypergraph. For example, this hypergraph corresponds to the incidence structure with point set A, B, C, D, line set E sub 1, E sub 2, and the following incidence relation. Interestingly, every incidence structure can also be viewed as a hypergraph. We can do this by letting the points of our incidence structure be the vertex set of our hypergraph. Then, for each line in the incidence structure, we create an edge that contains the vertices whose corresponding points were incident to that line. In other words, to form the edges of our hypergraph, we identify each line in the incidence structure with a set of points incident to it. To finish the video, let's recap what we've learned. Incidence geometry is the study of incidence structures, which are basically collections of two types of objects, points and lines, along with a single relationship between objects of different types, incidents. We have a lot of freedom when we attempt to pictorially represent an incidence structure. Lines don't have to be straight, they can be curved, and points can be spaced apart as much or as little as we want. And the order that points appear in the lines in our pictorial representation are not a feature of the incidence structure itself. Incidence structures that can be drawn in the Euclidean plane with only points and straight line segments are known as realizable. Uniform incidence structures are those where all lines have the same number of incident points. Incidence structures can be represented with a binary incidence matrix, whose rows correspond to points and whose columns correspond to lines. The dual of an incidence structure S is the incidence structure S star, whose incidence matrix is the transpose of the incidence matrix of S. Finally, incidence structures can be seen as hypergraphs and vice versa. That's it for this video. In future videos, we'll take a look at some more relationships between incidence structures and graph theory. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe. Have a great day.